army, however, instead of following the Peshiera road, suddenly turns to the left and marches along the Adige. It arrives before the day at Ronco. Andreozzi was completing a bridge over the river, and when the first rays of the sun appeared, the army was astonished to find itself simply by facing to the left on the opposite bank. The officers and soldiers who went in pursuit of Wurmser had traversed this part of the country now began to guess the general's intention. They perceived that as he could not carry Caldero, he was turning it, and that being unable 12,000 men to make any impression on 45,000 in the plain, he was drawing them into mere causeways among vast morasses where numbers could no longer avail of anything, but where the courage of the heads of the columns would be everything. The hopes of victory then reanimated every heart, and everyone engaged to surpass his former deeds in support of so fine and so daring a plan. Kilmaine was left at Verona with 1,500 soldiers of all kinds. The gates were strictly closed, and all communications severely prohibited. The enemy was perfectly ignorant of our movement. The bridge of Ronco was thrown across the right of the Alpen, about a quarter of a league from its mouth. Had it been made to the left bank on the Alboreto side, the army would have passed into a plain, whereas the object was to enter morasses where numbers would be ineffectual. Besides, it was to be apprehended that Alvinzi, if informed of our movements, would march suddenly on Verona and take possession of it, which would have obliged the corps of Rivoli to retire to Peschiera, and would it compromise that of Ronco? It was therefore requisite to cross to the right bank of the Alpen, so as to fall in the rear of the enemy if they should attack Verona, and thereby support that place by the left bank, which could not have been done if the bridge had been thrown across the left bank of the Alpen, because the enemy could have lined up the right bank of that river and thus protected, have carried Verona. These two reasons had determined the placing of the bridge. Now three roads branched from Ronco, where the bridge had been made, all of which were surrounded with morasses. The first leads to Verona up the Adige, the second to Villa Nova, passing by Arcole, where there is a bridge a league and a half from the Adige over the little stream of Alpon. The third runs down the side of the Adige to Alboreto. Seventh, the Battle of Arcole, first day, 15th of November. Three columns directed their march by the three roads that on the left reascended the Adige as far as the extremity of the morasses. Thence, the communication with Verona was unimpeded. This point was one of the utmost importance. By securing it, all apprehensions of seeing Verona attacked by the enemy were removed, because the French would have been in the rear. The column of the right took the road to Alboreto and occupied it as far as the Alpon. That of the center advanced on Arcole, where our skirmishers reached the bridge without being perceived. It was 5 o'clock in the morning, and the enemy knew nothing of our proceedings. The first shots were fired on the bridge of Arcole, where two battalions of Croats with two pieces of cannon were in bivouac as a corps of observation to guard the rear of the army. Where were all the parks, and to watch the parties which the garrison of Lenago might detach into the plain? That place was only 3 leagues off. The enemy had been so negligent as not to advance any post to the Adige. They looked on this space as impracticable marshes. The interval from Arcole to the Adige is not guarded. The enemy had contented themselves with sending some patrols of hussars, who twice a day rode over the dikes and reconnoitered the Adige. The road from Ronco to Arcole meets the Alpon at 2 miles from Ronco, and then reascends the right bank of that little stream for a mile up to the bridge, which turns perpendicularly to the right and enters the village of Arcole. Some Croats are bivouacked, with their right supported on the village and their left towards the mouth of the rivulet. This bivouac had in front the dike from which it was separated only by the rivulet. By firing in front, they took the column, the head of which was advancing on Arcole in flank. It was necessary to fall back hastily to that point of the road, the side of which was no longer exposed to the left bank. Alvinzi was informed that some firing had taken place at the bridge of Arcole, but he paid little attention to the circumstance. However, at daybreak, the movement of the French could be distinguished from Caldero and the neighboring steeples. already the reconnoitering parties of hoosters, which every morning rode along the banks of the Adige to ascertain the events of the night, were received with a fire of musketry on all the decks and pursued by the French cavalry. Alvizi then received from all quarters certain intelligence that the French had passed the Adige and were in force on all the dikes. It seemed to him folly to suppose that the whole army could thus have been thrown into impracticable morasses. He rather thought it must be a detachment placed there to harass him whilst he should be attacked in force from the side of Verona, but his reconnoitering party on the side of Verona, having brought him intelligence that all was quiet there, Alvinzi thought it necessary to repulse these French troops beyond the Adige for the security of his rear. He ordered one division to advance by the Dike of Arcole and another towards the dike, which runs parallel with the Adige, with orders to fall furiously on all they should meet and drive them all into the river. Accordingly, towards 9 o'clock, these two divisions made a brisk attack. Massena, who was entrusted with the left dike, having allowed the enemy to advance, charged them furiously, broke them, caused them considerable loss, and took a great number of prisoners. The same thing was done on the dike of Arcole. They waited until the Austrians had turned the elbow of the bridge. They then charged and routed them and took many prisoners. It became of the utmost importance to gain possession of Arcole, because that was the point from whence to debouch on the rear of the enemy before they could be formed. But this bridge of Arcole, by its situation, resisted all of our attacks. Napoleon in person tried a last effort. He seized a standard, rushed towards the bridge, and fixed it there. The column he led had half cleared the bridge when the flank fire caused their attack to fail. The grenadiers of the head of the column, abandoned by their rear, hesitate. They are induced to retire, but they will not abandon their general. They seize him by his arms, his hair, and his clothes, and drag him along with them in their flight. Amidst the dead, the dying, the fire and the smoke, the general in chief is thrown into a marsh where he sinks up to the middle. He is in the midst of the enemy, but the French perceive that their general is not amongst them. A cry is heard of soldiers forward to rescue the general. These brave men instantly turn and rush upon the enemy. They drive them beyond the bridge and Napoleon is saved. That was a day of military self-devotion. General Lannes had hastened from Milan. He had been wounded at Governolo. He was still suffering, yet he threw himself between the enemy and Napoleon, covering him with his body, and received 3 wounds, resolved never to quit him. Miron, aide-de-camp to the general-in-chief, was killed whilst covering his general, affecting an heroic death. Belliard and Vignol were wounded whilst rallying the troops and urged them forward. The brave General Robert was killed there. A bridge was now thrown over at the mouth of the Alpine in order to take Arcole in rear, but in the meantime, Alvizi, formed of the true state of affairs and excessively alarmed with respect to the danger of his situation, had abandoned Caldiero, destroyed his batteries, and made all his parks, baggage, and reserves repass the Alpine. From the top of the steeple of Ronco, the French saw with regret the escape of their expected prey, and it was then that, from the precipitate movements of the enemy, the extent and consequences of the French general's plan became apparent. Everyone saw what might have been the result of so profound and bold a conception. The enemy's army narrowly escaped destruction. General Guillot could not march on Arcole by the left bank of the Alpine until 4 o'clock. The village was carried without striking a blow, but this success was then useless. It was 6 hours too late. The enemy had established themselves in a natural position. Arcole was now merely an intermediate post between the fronts of the two armies. In the morning, this village had been in the rear of the enemy. The results of this day were, however, highly important. Caldiero was evacuated in Verona, no longer in danger. 2 of Alvizi's divisions had been defeated with considerable loss. Numerous columns of prisoners and a great number of trophies defiled through the camp, filling the soldiers and officers with enthusiasm, and everyone was in confidence and exulted in victory. 8. Second day, 16th of November. In the meantime, Davidovich, with his corps from the Tyrol, had attacked the heights of Rivoli the preceding day. He had forced Vauban from thence and obliged him to retreat on Castelnuovo. The enemy's light horse already appeared at the gates of Verona. Kilmaine, disengaged from Alvizi and relieved from all apprehensions with respect to the left bank, By the evacuation of Cal, the Arrow had directed all its attention to the right bank, but it was to be feared that if the enemy should march rapidly on Castle Novo, they might overthrow Vaubois, reach Mantua, surprise the besieging army, join the garrison, and cut off the retreat of the headquarters and of the army, which was at Ronco. It was therefore necessary to be ready at daybreak to support Vaubois, protect Mantua and its communications, and beat Zavadovich if he had advanced during the day. For the success of this plan, it was necessary to calculate the hours. The general resolved, therefore, being uncertain of what had passed in the course of the day, to suppose if Vaubois had been completely unfortunate, he caused Arcole, which had cost so much blood, to be evacuated and the whole army to fall back on the right bank of the Adige, leaving on the left bank only one brigade and a few pieces of cannon. In this position, he ordered the troops to refresh themselves whilst waiting for intelligence of what might have passed on Vaubois' side during this day. If the enemy had marched to Castelnuovo, it would have been necessary to break up the bridge over the Adige to withdraw from before Alvinzi, and it being at 10 o'clock in the rear of Vaubois at Castelnuovo, and overthrow the enemy on Rivoli, bivouacs with fires lighted had been left at Arcole, as well as strong pickets, in order that Alvinzi might perceive nothing. At 4 in the morning, the drums beat to arms in order to prepare for marching, but at the same moment, it was ascertained that Vaubois was still in position halfway between Rivoli and Castelnuovo, and that he declared he would answer for holding out all day. Davidovich was the same general who had commanded one of the divisions which Wurmser had caused to debouch by the Cusa. He remembered the results of those operations and was not forward to compromise himself. Towards 3 o'clock in the morning, however, Alvinzi, having received intelligence of the retrograde march of the French, had Arcole occupied immediately, and at dawn directed two columns on the dikes of the Adige and of Arcole to march against us. The firing began at 200 toises from our bridge. The troops repassed it in charging time, fell on the enemy, broke them, and pursued them briskly to the debouches of the morasses, which were filled with their dead. Some collars, cannon, and prisoners were the trophies of this victory, in which two divisions more of Alvinzi's force were defeated. Towards evening, the French general, through the same motives and combinations, made the same movement as the preceding day. He concentrated all his troops on the right bank of the Adige, leaving only a vanguard on the left bank. The 9th, 3rd day, 17th of November. In the meantime, Alvinzi, led into error by a spy who assured him that the French general had repassed the Adige and marched on Mantua, leaving only a rear guard at Ronco, debouched at daybreak with the intention of carrying the bridge of Ronco. An instant before day, it was ascertained that nothing had taken place on Vaubois' side, and that Davidovich had made no movement. The French returned to the other side of the Adige. The head of our columns fell in with two more of Alvinzi's divisions halfway up the dikes. An obstinate engagement was fought. Our troops alternately advanced and fell back. For one moment, the enemy's balls reached the bridge. The 75th having been broken, the general-in-chief placed in the 32nd in ambuscade, lying on their faces in a little wood of willows along the dike of Arcole. This demi-brigade rose, fired a volley, charged bayonets, and overthrew into the marsh a dense column of the enemy consisting of 3,000 Croats, who all perished there. Massena on the left experienced some vicissitudes, but he marched at the head of his division with his hat suspended on his sword by way of a standard and made a horrible carnage of the division opposed to him. After midnight, the French general concluded that the decisive moment was arrived, for if Vaubois had been beaten during the day by Davidovich, he would be obliged to march the following day to the assistance of that general in Mantua. Alvinzi would then immediately advance on Verona. He would reap the honor and advantages of victory. The great success obtained during the last 3 days would be thrown away. Napoleon had the prisoners carefully counted, recapitulated the losses of the enemy, concluded that their strength had been diminished during these 3 days by a loss of 20,000 men, that the numbers in battle would therefore be little more than a third above our own. He gave orders to leave the marshes and to attack the enemy in the plain. The circumstances of these 3 days had so entirely changed the spirit of the two armies that we were secure of the victory. The army passed the bridge thrown over at the mouth of the Alpen. Elliot, aide-de-camp to the general-in-chief, being ordered to construct a second, was killed there. At 2 o'clock in the morning, the French army was in line of battle, its left at Arcole and its right in the direction of Porto Lignano. It had the enemy in front, whose right was supported on the Alpen, and whose left had some morasses for an upwee. The enemy had positions on both sides of the road of Montebello. Adjutant Lorset had set out from Lignano with 600 to 700 men, 4 pieces of cannon, and 200 horses to turn the marshes on which the enemy was supported. Towards 3 o'clock, at the moment when this detachment of the garrison of Lignano marched against the enemy, when the cannonade was brisk throughout the line, the skirmishers were hotly engaged. The French general ordered Coeur de Hercule to proceed with 50 of the corps of guys and 4 or 5 trumpets through the reeds and to charge the extremity of the enemy's left at the same moment as the garrison of Lignano should begin to cannonade it in the rear, which he executed in an intelligent manner and thereby contributed greatly to the success of the day. The enemy were overthrown on all sides. Their line was broken. They lost many prisoners. Alvinzi had placed 7,000 or 8,000 men in echelon in his rear to secure his retreat and escort his parks, whereby his line of battle was reduced to equal strength with ours. He was vigorously chased all the rest of the evening. He continued his retreat on Vicenza. Throughout the night, our cavalry pursued him beyond Montebello. When Napoleon arrived at Montenova, he stopped to receive reports of the pursuit of the enemy and the conduct of the rear guard. He entered the convent of St. Boniface, the church of which had served as a hospital. There he found 400 or 500 wounded men, most of them dead. The stench of putrefaction exhaled from the place. He drew back with horror. He heard himself called by his name. 2 unfortunate French soldiers wounded, half for 3 days been left amongst the dead, without anything to eat. Their wounds had not been dressed. They despaired of their own lives, but they were recalled to existence by the side of their general. Every assistance was speedily rendered to them. The French general visited the heights of Caldiero and resumed his march towards Verona. When halfway there, he met an Austrian staff officer sent by Davidovich to Alvinzi. This young man thought himself in the midst of his friends. According to his dispatches, there had been no communication between the two armies for 3 days. Davidovich was ignorant of all that had happened. 10. The French army re-enters Verona in triumph by the right bank. Napoleon entered triumphantly into Verona by the right bank 3 days after having left that city in a mysterious manner by the Milan Gate. It would be difficult to conceive the astonishment and enthusiasm of the inhabitants. Our most declared enemies could not remain indifferent and added their applause to that of our friends. The French general crossed to the right bank of the Adige and advanced on Davidovich, who was still at Rivoli. That general was driven from post to post and hotly pursued as far as Rovereto. It is calculated that out of Alvinzi's 60 or 70,000 men, he lost in these affairs from 30 to 35,000. And these were the best of his troops. But these great results were not obtained without losses, and the army stood more than ever in need of rest. The French general did not think fit to re-enter the Tyrol and extended his forces as far as Trent. He contented himself with having Montebello, Corona, and the passes of the Chiusa and Adige occupied. Alvinzi rallied at Bassano and Davidovich at Trent. It was, however, to be expected that match would soon be obtained before the Austrian general could receive a new army. The frequent sorties of Worms were to obtain a few provisions, a great number of lean deserters who came in and had been a month kept on half rations. The destitute state of his hospitals and the great number of his sick were all calculated to excite hopes of a speedy surrender. The Battle of Rivoli. 1. State of Italy. Venice was making new levies of Sclavonians. New battalions of them arrived daily on the lagoons. The various parties were on alert in all the cities of the Venetian territory. The citadels of Verona and Brescia were in the possession of the French troops. Some troubles which happened at Bergamo made it evidently necessary to occupy the citadel there, of which General Barrigay d'Illiera took possession accordingly. The negotiations with Rome were kept on, but did not proceed. Experience had proved that nothing could be done with that court but by threats and the presence of force. The general-in-chief announced at Milan his departure for Rome. He dispatched General Lajos with 4,000 Italians for Bologna, directed a body of 3,000 French on the same city, and gave notice to the Grand Duke of Tuscany that his troops would traverse the states of that prince in their way to Perugia. He actually set out himself and went to Bologna. Manfredini went thither to meet him for the purpose of taking care of his master's interest and returned with the conviction that the French general was marching on Rome. For this, once the court was not the dupe of all these appearances, but remained unmoved. It was perfectly acquainted with all the plans adopted at Vienna, and had hopes of their success. When, however, it found that the French general was at Bologna, the Secretary of State was astonished. But the Austrian minister kept up his courage by convincing him that nothing could be more favorable to their views than to draw the French general into the interior of Italy, and that even should it be necessary to quit Rome, it would be a fortunate event, as it would more effectually secure the defeat of the French on the Adige to situation of the Austrian army. Alvisi daily received considerable reinforcements. The Padua and the Trevisan and all the Bassanese countries were covered with Austrian troops. 2 months had elapsed since the Battle of Arcole. Austria had profited by this interval to bring in Friuli, the divisions drawn from the banks of the Rhine, where the French armies were inactive and incomplete winter quarters. One general impulse had been given to the whole Austrian monarchy. Several battalions of excellent marksmen were raised in the Tyrol. It was an easy matter to persuade them that it was necessary to defend the territory and to assist in the request, the reconquest of Italy, so essential to the prosperity of the Tyrol. The successes of Austria and Germany during the last campaign and her reverses in Italy had roused public spirit. The great cities offered battalions of volunteers. Vienna furnished 4. Thus was a reinforcement of 10 or 12,000 volunteers raised. The battalions of Vienna received from the Empress colors embroidered with her own hands. They lost them, but defended them honorably. The army of Austria was composed of 8 divisions of unequal strength, of several brigades of cavalry incorporated with these divisions, and of 2 divisions of cavalry. His army was estimated at more than 80,000 fighting men. 3. Situation of the French army. The French army had been reinforced since the Battle of Arcole by 2 regiments of infantry drawn from the coast of Provence, of which the 57th was part, by a regiment of cavalry. This made up about 5 or 6,000 men and repaired the losses sustained at Arcole in the blockade of Mantua. Joubert, with a strong division, occupied Montebaldo Rivoli and Busolengo. Ray, with a division of less force, was in reserve at Desenzano. Massena was at Verona with the vanguard at San Michele. Augereau at Lignago with the vanguard at Bevilacqua. Serrier was blockading Mantua. Corona was covered with entrenchments. The castles of Verona and of Lignago were in good condition, as well as Peschiera and Pizzicatoni. The citadels of Brescia and Bergamo, the fort of Fuente, the citadel of Ferrara, and Fort Urbino were occupied. A naval armament on the Lake of Garda secured us the possession of that lake. Armed barks placed on Lake Maggiore and the Lake of Como kept up a strict police thereon. The 4th plan of operations adopted by the court of Vienna, Firmster had debouched in 3 columns his right by the road of the Chiusa beyond the Lake of Garda, his center by Montebaldo between the Lake of Garda and the Adige, his left by the left bank of the Adige. Some months afterwards, Alvisi had attacked the 2 columns, the one operating the Tyrol, the other on the Piave, the Brenta, and the Adige, but the battles of Lonato, Castiglione, and Arcole had defeated those 2 plans of campaign. The court of Vienna adopted this time a new plan, which was connected with the operations of Rome. It was determined that the Austrian army should make 2 grand attacks, the first by Montebaldo and Firmser had done, the second on the Adige by the plains of the Paduan country, that the 2 corps which were to execute these attacks should have nothing in common between them, that they should march independently of each other, so that if one should succeed, the first object would be gained and the blockade of Mantua raised. The principal corps was to debouch by the Tyrol, and if it should defeat, the French army would arrive under the walls of Mantua and there effect its junction with the second corps acting on the Adige. If, on the contrary, the principal attack should be defeated and the second corps should succeed, the siege of Mantua would equally be raised and the place reprovisioned. This army would then march to the Seraglio and establish its communications with Rome. Marshal Wurmser would take the command of the army, which was in Romania. The great number of generals, officers, and dismounted cavalry who would be found at Mantua would serve to discipline the Pope's army and make a diversion which would oblige the French general to have also two armies, one on the left and the other on the right bank of the Po. Very intelligent secret agent sent from Vienna was seized by a French sentinel as he was clearing the last post of the French army before Mantua. He was forced to give up his dispatches, which he had swallowed, enclosed in a little ball of sealing wax. This dispatch was a little letter written in a very minute hand, signed by the Emperor Francis. It was to inform Wurmser that he would speedily be extricated. At all events, it ordered him not to surrender himself prisoner, but rather to evacuate the place and pass the Po, which he could do as Lai was master, was of the Seraglio, and to proceed to the state of the Pope, where he was to take the command of that potentate's army. The Emperor of Austria supposed, as may be seen, that Wurmser was master of the Seraglio. He was, however, ill-informed. 5. Action of Saint Michel. In execution of the plan adopted by the court of Vienna, Provera had the command of the army intended to act on the Adige to pass that river and advance in Mantua. The volunteer battalions of Vienna composed part of the army, which consisted of 3 divisions containing 25,000 men. In the beginning of January, Provera removed his headquarters to Padua. On the 12th, he marched with 2 divisions on Montagna, where the vanguard of Augereau, commanded by the brave General Dufault, was stationed. At the same instant, the 3rd Austrian division, which had taken up a position in the heights of Caldiero, marched on St. Michel to attack Massena's vanguard, whose headquarters were at Verona. This was a false attack. General Dufault, being attacked at daybreak by the vanguard of Provera, composed of the volunteers of Vienna, easily checked and repulsed them. But about noon, the whole Austrian army, having deployed, Dufault retreated and repassed the Adige at Lignago. The division which formed Provera's right and which attacked St. Michel was the weakest. General Massena marched from Verona to the aid of his vanguard. The Austrian division was broken, dispersed, and pursued with great slaughter beyond the Alpine. At this juncture, the French general arrived post from Bologna. He had received intelligence from his Venetian agents of the movement of the Austrian army on Padua. He had made the Italian troops encamp on the frontier of the Transpadan County to oppose the Pope, ordered the 2,000 French from Bologna to march on Ferrara, where they had passed the Po at Ponte di Legoscuro, and joined the army on the Adige. He passed the Po in person at Borgoforte, repaired to the headquarters at Roverbella, and reached Verona in the heat of the action of St. Michel. He instantly ordered Massena to withdraw in the night all his troops upon Verona. The enemy appeared to be in operation, and it was necessary to keep all the troops disposable in order to march to whatever quarter the true attack should be made on. In the course of the night, news arrived from the headquarters at Lignago that the whole Austrian army was in movement on the Lower Adige, that the Grand Staff of the enemy were all there, as well as 2 pontoon trains. The report of General Dufault, a confidential officer, left no doubt with respect to the numerous forces deployed before him. He reckoned them at 20,000 men and supposed them to form the enemy's first line. The opinion that the enemy were operating on the Lower Adige was confirmed by the intelligence of what had passed at Corona. Schubert sent word that during the whole of the 12th, he had been attacked by the enemy who he had withstood, and that the Austrian division had been repulsed in all its attacks. 6. General Vinzi occupies Corona and throws a bridge over the Adige. The French general ordered Massena's division to repass the Adige and to join on the right bank. He thus awaited all day on the 13th the events which might have occurred on the same day at Lignago, on the Adige, and at Corona. The troops received notice to prepare for a nocturnal march and to be under arms at 10 o'clock at night. The division which was at Desenzano marched on the 11th to Castelnuovo, where it awaited fresh orders. The rain fell in torrents. The troops were under arms, but the general chief did not as yet know in what direction he should order them to proceed. At 10 o'clock, the reports from Montebaldo and the Lower Adige arrived. Schubert wrote that on the 13th, at 9 in the morning, the enemy had deployed numerous forces, that he had fought all day, that his position was very confined, that he had been fortunate enough to maintain himself there, but that at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, after perceiving that he was outflanked on the left by the march of an Austrian division, which proceeded along the Lake of Garda, and seemed to threaten to place itself between Peschiera and him, and on his right by another division of the enemy which had proceeded along the left bank of the Adige, thrown a bridge over a league above Rivoli, crossed that river and was filing along the right bank, passing along the foot of Montebaldo to carry the level of Rivoli. He had considered it indispensably necessary to send a brigade to secure the level of Rivoli, the key of the whole position, and that about 4 o'clock he had himself deemed it requisite to abandon Corona in order to arrive at daylight at the level of Rivoli, which he should be compelled to evacuate the following morning before 9 o'clock on the Lower Adige. The enemy had lined the left bank. We were on the right bank. The enemy's plan was therefore discovered. It was evident that he was operating with two grand armies on Montebaldo and the Lower Adige. Ogoro's division appeared sufficient to dispute and defend the passage of that river at Montebaldo. There was not a moment to be lost, because the enemy was about to join his cavalry and artillery by taking possession of the level of Rivoli. And if he could be attacked before he should gain that important point, he would be obliged to fight without artillery or cavalry. Nor was doubtful that the principal attack of the enemy was by Montebaldo. All the troops were therefore dispatched to the level of Rivoli, whither the general-in-chief also repaired in person at 2 o'clock in the morning. 7. Battle of Rivoli. The weather had cleared up, and it was beautiful moonlight. Napoleon ascended several heights and observed the different lines of the enemy's fires. They filled the country between the Adige and the Lake of Garda. The atmosphere was reddened by them. 5 corps were easily distinguished, which seemed formed on 5 divisions, which had commenced their movement the day before. Judging by the fires of the bivouacs, it seemed that there were about 40 or 50,000 men. The French should be at Rivoli by 6 in the morning, to the number 22,000 men. This was indeed a very great disproportion, but we had the advantage of possessing 60 pieces of cannon, several thousand cavalry. It was evident from the position of the bivouacs of the enemy that they intended to attack us towards 9 or 10 in the morning. The column of the right, which was most distant, was intended to surround the level of Rivoli in the rear. It could not come up before 10 o'clock. The object of the first division of the center seemed to be to attack the position of our left. The second, which was on the upper ridge of Montebaldo near St. Marco, was intended to gain possession of the chapel of St. Marco to descend by the level of Rivoli and to open the way to the left column, which had passed along the foot of Montebaldo and was in bivouac at the edge of the level along the Adige at the bottom of the valley.